Welcome everybody to the 10th talk in this series, and this is the final one, and we are indeed very happy and to have with us Thomas Sutton, who's the Chief Design Officer of Frog Design in the EMEA region. He leads the Frog Design Group. So good evening to everyone and good afternoon, Thomas. First of all, I'd like to thank you a lot, Thomas, for, in spite of your busy schedule, to have spared time for us and for young design aspirants from India. We really appreciate that. We are very grateful for your gesture.
Pleasure.
Yeah.
My pleasure.
Okay. So I hand it over to you, Thomas. You can perhaps briefly tell us about your journey in design, and then you can present your topic. That's okay?
Great. Yep.
Yes. And after that, usually we have a question and answer session. And in the Q&A, I would request people to please also turn on their videos so it becomes more interactive. Okay. Over to you, Thomas. Thank you.
Okay. Great. A real pleasure for me to have the opportunity to talk to you today. Maybe I'll start with a little bit about me. I'm born and grew up in New Zealand. This is my hometown that you see in the photo. My hometown of Wellington. New Zealand is a beautiful country, very small country, very far from everywhere else. The whole country, population of the whole country is about half the population of Pune. When I grew up there, I didn't know anyone who was a designer. I had never really heard of designer as a job. I knew plenty of people who were farmers, some people who were architects or scientists or engineers, but designer was not something I had heard of. But at the same time, as I was from when I was a small child, I knew that what I wanted to do was to design new things. I didn't have a word for it. I thought maybe that meant I would be an inventor or a crazy scientist or something. And quite by accident, when I finished high school, I was helping a friend of mine who was applying to some different fine arts and design programs in New Zealand. I was supporting him with his application, and I read the description of the industrial design program at Victoria University, and I was like, oh, so that's what it's called. That's what I want to do. And so I decided last minute to also apply to the industrial design program, trained in New Zealand as an industrial designer. And spent a couple of years working there after I graduated. When I was 24, 25 years old, I realized that it was probably the right time to test myself on a larger stage than I would be able to find in my home country. So emigrated to Europe, thinking I would stay for 3 years, 5 years maybe, and get some international experience. And I ended up in Milan in Italy, where I have lived ever since. So now about half my life I have spent here in Italy. And what I ended up working on when I arrived in Italy was designing medical devices. And I absolutely fell in love with that domain. It had a lot of the things that I was looking for in design. It had a lot of technical innovation, which I enjoy a lot. It had a lot of complexity, which I enjoy a lot. It had a lot of, let's say, inherent significance or meaning or value in the work, which is important for me, for my own motivation. And so throughout my career, that's something I've stayed close to, is designing for a healthcare space, initially primarily in medical devices, physical devices, and then over the years also more in digital health and in health service design. And that continues to be a domain that I'm very passionate about. In parallel to that, obviously I've taken on a variety of organizational roles. I had the opportunity to open the Frog Studio in Milan 15 years ago, currently responsible for the design team across our locations in Europe and in India. So that's a little bit my story. Now a little bit about Frog, my current workplace and home in many ways. This is our studio in Milan that you see in the picture. I'm sure some of you have heard about Frog, but I'll just share a few notions about what we do in Frog to get started. So Frog, as a company, is now in our 52nd year. The company was founded in the start of 1969. And over these five decades, you know, we've consistently been focused on designing human-centered experiences, on recognizing that human beings are complex. They have complex functional needs. They have complex emotional needs. They make complex choices. And that if we don't recognize and embrace and design for that human complexity, then we are failing, let's say, in our mission and our mandate as designers. And that was captured early on by our founder, Hartmut Esslinger, in his catchphrase or call to action, call to arms, which was form follows emotion. Right? So in contrast to the dominant thinking of, let's say, the good design movement in Germany at the time, which was form follows function, form follows emotion was really a call to consider the non-rational elements of human beings. And it's important to recognize we're not talking about the emotions of the designer. We are not saying that design is a form of personal expression for individual designers. We're saying design is at the service of customers, of end users, but it needs to tap into their emotions. And the other key part of Esslinger's philosophy was design is a strategic driver for growth for businesses. If you get that right, if you successfully tap into the emotions of end users and customers, you can drive business growth and business success. And the history of Frog has been very much a history of partnership with people who believed in that as we do. People who had the courage to believe that they could change the world, that they could take their businesses in a radical new direction, that could do that with the help of great design. And that journey, you know, early in that journey included our partnerships with Sony, and with Apple, and with many great business leaders and entrepreneurs who embraced that shared philosophy. And when we talk about driving growth and business success with design today, there's really two macro domains or mechanisms by which we do that. The first is really around building future value by launching new businesses. And I say new businesses, not just new products, right? Another product, another Me Too product in an existing category is not necessarily building much future value. If you're launching more breakthrough products and services, typically they bring with them, as almost as a necessity, new business models and new business opportunities. And so when we work with large companies launching new products and services outside their core, or when we work with entrepreneurs and growth businesses launching new products and services, we emphasize a lot the fact that in doing so, in launching a new innovative product and service, you are also launching a new business, and we need to give as much attention to the business side of that as we do to the design and human experience side. The other way that design drives growth is through orchestrating experiences. What do I mean by orchestrating? Any large organization today has multiple different touch points and moments of interaction with their customers that can be through digital applications, websites, call centers, physical offices or retail outlets, in-person services, and there is, you know, self-service touch points. There's a huge plethora of ways with which a business interacts with its customers, and typically these are organized as different product teams in different silos within the organization. And although the individual products may be well designed, individual touch points may be well designed, they do not add up to a well-designed and coherent journey for the user as the user goes through working with a company's mobile application, their website, their call center, whatever other touch points. They often feel the fragmentation and the lack of coherence along that journey. And so to really differentiate an experience today, it is not enough to make great individual products. It's really about the ability to orchestrate it at scale across multiple products and multiple touch points to create coherent user journeys. And so the example that you see here is the entire digital ecosystem, self-service ecosystem for a large telco that we've been working on, actually with our design studios in India. While the example on the left is an Israeli startup, MIMED, for whom we have designed and developed a complete point-of-care diagnostics system for distinguishing bacterial and viral infections. And that's a typical example of launching a brand new business into a new category where there currently are no direct competitors. So in order to do these things, right, to create value through design by launching new businesses, by orchestrating experiences at scale, we've found that there are three key areas where our clients need our support. The first is in their decision-making, right? Decision-making is, from my perspective, the plain English way of saying strategy, right? Strategy is an overused word, means so many different things, but ultimately what strategy is making choices, deciding we will do this and we will not do that, right? That's what strategy is. And traditional strategy methods tend to guide companies towards conservative choices, towards safe choices. and that makes it very hard for them to innovate. And Frog, as a strategy partner, really focuses on how do we help our clients to make bolder choices, which starts with using the power of design to imagine, to explore what the future could be like, to find the future that you want to create for your business and for your customers. And then from there, work backwards to understand what is the path to get there? How can I de-risk it? How can we get to that future that we want to create? And if you don't do that, you'll not end up having sufficient ambition to really make great products. Any great product starts with having sufficient ambition, sufficient boldness about what you're trying to achieve. But there is much more to that, of course, to making better products, right? It's if we really want to make things that people love to use, whatever they are, whether they're digital or physical or spatial or services, then we need to be great at understanding people's needs, understanding people's unmet needs, understanding what people want, understanding what people will do. But we also need to be great at building things. Right? It's not enough to design a great product if then the execution is poor. So what we've really tried to do in our ability to create better products is to really bring the world of human-centered design with its focus on understanding people, understanding their needs, and understanding new opportunity spaces for them with the world of, say, modern product development with lean and agile methodologies, product management, and so on, to be able to not only come up with great designs, but to bring those great designs to market. The third thing that we have realized is that whenever a company tries to do something new, they find themselves with an organizational structure that is inadequate to achieve that. All right, the organizational structure that you have is adequate to do what you are currently doing. Whenever you try to do something new, you will find that you have gaps. There are new things that you need to learn how to do. There are new roles that you're missing, capabilities that you're missing, processes that you're missing, tools that you're missing in order to fulfill against your new mission. We have developed a strong kind of organizational design and organizational activation capability that really focuses on strengthening our clients' teams, our clients' internal capabilities, so that they can scale and sustain customer-centric, human-centric innovation on the inside. So that is our footprint and our focus today from a capabilities and offerings perspective. Our geographical footprint is very much global. We were born in Europe and maintain a strong footprint in Europe today. A lot of our history has been very tightly connected with the United States, with Silicon Valley in particular, and the U.S. continues to be a strong market for us. We have recently opened our first studio in Latin America, in Mexico City. In Asia, we were one of the first global consultancies to open in Shanghai and have built a very strong and unique practice in Shanghai, which today I would say has overtaken by far Silicon Valley as the true hub for technological innovation globally. And last but not least, we have two studios in India. We have some alumni from this school in our studios in India, which are now 3 years old and an integral part of our global delivery model, both for projects, supporting project teams in Europe and North America, as well as some really nice innovation projects for local Indian clients. And unlike many global consultancies, this is not a network of loosely affiliated studios. This is really a global organization that works together across studios every day, literally every day, which is a very enriching experience for all of us and a key value proposition to clients that are struggling with the complexity of global markets. And in terms of markets, I think another key value proposition that we bring is really a very much a cross-industry perspective. We have a lot of depth in some key industries. We have very strong capabilities in healthcare. We have very strong capabilities in financial services, in telecommunications, and automotive, consumer and retail. So we have people who are true experts in those domains. But for most people who work at Frog, you could be jumping from a project in one domain to a project in another domain to a project in a third domain in the course of a few months. And that's incredibly enriching for us as an experience as designers, but also very enriching for our clients, because ways of thinking and doing design within industries can become quite stagnant and conform to the paradigms of that industry. And cross-industry fertilization is a key mechanism for continuing to evolve and to innovate in any industry. So that's a little bit about me and a little bit about Frog. Now I want to move on to the topic of the talk today, which is somewhat ambitiously the future of things. What do I mean by the future of things? Broadly speaking, I'm an industrial designer. This is an industrial design school that I'm talking at, and industrial design has been radically impacted by these last two decades of software-driven disruption, right, to our everyday lives. And I think some of the things, some of the axioms that I learned that guided my work as a young industrial designer 25 years ago need to evolve and have evolved in response to this software-driven world. And so to some degree, this is a talk for an industrial designer in 2020 thinking about, okay, what's the role of physical product design over the next 20 years? What's my relevance? How should I think about physical products when so much of the world is seems to be driven and dominated by software and by digital solutions? And I'm going to start by taking a step back from that and just talking about things. By things, I mean objects, physical things, and how we can think about things more generally. And I do that by talking about things in the context of activity. And since this is a talk for an Indian audience, I decided, by a New Zealander, I decided I could use cricket as a metaphor. So let's talk about activity. People's activities are often quite mysterious to an outsider, right? Without context. Why is this grown man trying to hit a ball with a stick? What's the guy behind him trying to do? And why are there tens of thousands of people spending all day watching them? Right? You arrive to the scene without context, it's completely mystifying. But because it's a well-codified activity, we know what they're doing. We know the batsman is trying to score runs. We know the keeper is trying to knock him out. Why are they doing those things? Well, because they're each participating in a game of cricket. And why are they participating in a game of cricket? Probably they're participating in some kind of a championship. And this illustrates something which is critical when we think about activity, which is its hierarchical nature, right? There is an operational layer, the actions of the batsman, which are completely subconscious as the ball comes at him at 150 kilometers an hour, and he strikes it, right? He can't think about what he's doing there. He just does it. It's the operational level. Then there are his actions, which is the conscious level. He's seen, he's mapped the position of the fieldsman on the field, and he's decided where he should strike. And then above the action level is the activity level, right? This is the game or the championship, which is where the meaning of all of this comes from. So he's engaging in this activity which is given meaning by its high-level goal, right? The high-level goal is sometimes referred to as the object. And interestingly, it is quite often literally objectified, right? In this case, it is objectified by the cup. The championship cup is an object which represents the objective of this whole activity, the trophy in this man's hands. And if we look at the faces of these players, we can see that it's that both the pursuit and the attainment of the object is incredibly fulfilling. There is some really deep meaning there, right? Something deep, some deep human meaning, some deep human need is being fulfilled. But we are not born with the need to win cricket championships, right? That's not directly the need. That's the objective that we're pursuing, but the needs that we are fulfilling don't belong to the activity, they belong to us, right? And so we can start to see in this photo some clues about the needs that are being fulfilled here. Self-realization, the comradeship with other people, sense of identification in something bigger than yourself, a sense of participation in something bigger than yourself. These are core human needs that we are born with, right? But we can realize those needs, we can fulfill those needs in a broad variety of ways, and we fulfill them through activities, right? So if we put all this stuff together, we have this basic concept of an activity system, right? So an activity system in its simplest form says there's a subject, it's a person who has the ability to act and the need to act, and they do act in order to fulfill their needs. And then we have the object, right, which is something that enables the subject to meet their needs and it motivates them to perform their activity. In the absence of the object, the activity does not occur. And the critical thing for us as designers in this picture is tool mediation, right? All human activities today are tool mediated. We do them with the support of tools. The tools themselves can become so imbued with meaning that they become in their own right the object of the activity, right? Put a cricket ball and bat in the hands of any child in India or in New Zealand, and they will start to play with it. Right, the object contains the activity in itself. Although if you put those objects to a child in America who has never seen a cricket game, they would not know what to do with them and probably would not use them. Right? So the tool is imbued with meaning, it's part of a cultural context, and becomes in its own right the object of activity. And this is really important for us as designers, as industrial designers, to recognize, you know, this dual nature of the object. It has a functional role. It enables us to do certain things. It enables us to perform certain activities, but it also has a representative role. It represents the meaning of that activity. So that seems clear enough for a well-established activity, but what happens when we try to do something new? It happens when we make new things, when we make things that didn't previously exist. Right? This is something that I, as I mentioned before, it's what attracted me to designing in for healthcare, is because in many cases you are doing that kind of fundamental innovation. You're making a new kind of device, a new kind of solution that didn't previously exist. And new things, right? When you create new things, you create new activity systems. So you have a current situation, you have things, you have people, you have activities occurring in the current situation. You hypothesize that some new thing could be added to that situation and make it better. You add that new thing and suddenly you have a new situation which generates new opportunities, which generates new problems, which generates new needs, which generates new activity systems. And those new activity systems take root. They are sustainable, they are viable, they are scalable when they better fulfill people's needs. That is, in some ways, you know, the way that I feel most comfortable defining the concept of innovation, right? So innovation, what is the difference between something which is just another product and something which is truly innovative? Something that is truly innovative means you've added it to a system and it's changed the way people behave and it's achieved a better fit, better fulfillment of people's needs. And that leads me to a conclusion around design, which is that, you know, we often talk about design in terms of problem solving, but problem solving in some ways almost has this assumption that, you know, we can see the state of the world with some problems, with some gaps, right? Like potholes in the road, right? And so if there's a road with a pothole in it, you know, you need to go and fill the pothole so that the cars can get across. That's classical problem solving. However, I think, you know, design needs to be more ambitious than that and think about, you know, what roads do we need and where should they take us? And what is the, you know, how can we best enable human potential? So it is not so much in my mind about looking at the way things are today and fixing the problems with the way things are today, but much more about imagining future states and imagining what human potential could achieve and trying to build, you know, platforms, trying to build tools, trying to build new activity systems that enable that human potential. So when we do that, of course, we do it in a context. Everything is in a context, and everything is an evolving context, not a static context. So the next piece to look at is, you know, how do things evolve? How have things been evolving, and how might we see things evolving in the near future? And to talk about that, I'm going to go back a few hundred years to the invention of the Gutenberg press, right? This is one of the classic stories that is talked about in any history of material culture and the way that technology impacts society, right? Invention of the Gutenberg press was a completely radical new capability for humankind, right? The movable type printing press. However, when we look back on it from where we are today, we can imagine that it was a problem-solving approach, right? Because today, in a world where we publish newspapers and novels and, you know, the written word is everywhere in our lives, the need for a movable type printing system seems obvious. But at the time that the Gutenberg press was invented, it wasn't solving an existing problem. There weren't any publishing houses, there weren't any newspapers, there weren't any novels, right? Those things could only come into being after this technology became available. And so this was an invention that was all about enabling potential, right? It wasn't about addressing some pain point that people had with woodcuts. It was about enabling new potential. It was a visionary invention. And it created this massive step change in the ability to access, you know, written knowledge and culture. So it was a change in the means of production, right? From woodcut to movable type, that totally changed the culture of consumption. And then totally changed the culture of the cultural production of what authors could aspire to, and created, you know, a vast new activity system. So then if we step forward a few hundred years from there, the next really big, I want to say one more thing about that. The other thing that we have with the creation of the movable type press, of course, is the creation of typography as a discipline, right? So this revolutionary technology driving change led to the need for a new type of designer that would be able to design printed artifacts using this technology. The next big step forward in this story is the invention of the paperback. And this is another crazy, in some way, kind of counterintuitive move. There wasn't a huge pressure on the fact that hardcover books were expensive, right? Because the existing customers of expensive hardcover books were quite happy with their expensive hardcover books, right? And what this step change did, what the invention of the paperback, what the invention of the low-cost book did, was a huge step change in access to knowledge, access to the printed word. It was intimately connected to the universal suffrage movement, to the trade union movements, to the socialist movements around the world at the time. And it was about giving the working class access to culture. But in doing so, it also radically changed the nature of the culture itself, right? We could not have had Hemingway without the paperback. We could not have had Graham Greene without the paperback. So again, the new technology, the new product, the paperback book, radically changes the system, the activity system around production and consumption of the written word. And again, creates a new design challenge. Here you see the beautiful design system from Penguin, the leader, the inventor in some ways of the paperback. So this new level of mass production of books led to another step change in book design and in graphic design, and really this idea of design systems, which remains such a powerful idea today in our digital world, was born here. The next great change in the story of the written word was digital typesetting. So in the early 80s, with the first Macintosh, a whole industry of typesetting that was still based on people physically moving movable type around in printing machines started to transition to digital typesetting. And a whole set of professions and trades disappeared. You know, hundreds of thousands of jobs in the newspaper industry of people who were physically composing the daily newspaper transitioned to being digital typesetting jobs with, you know, a tenth of the workforce. But entirely new set of activities and economic opportunities emerged around universal access to the means of production. Right? So anybody could be a typesetter. Anyone could print a professional publication with a far lower access to capital than was previously required. And that radically changed the whole publishing industry and really was the beginning, well before the internet, of the design industry as we know it today. But we were still, after digitally typesetting books, we were still printing them, distributing them, selling them, consuming them, as we had been previously. Until the next big change, which was a change to the downstream value chain, to the way that books were discovered, purchased, distributed to people with the online bookstore, this was not only a change, and not primarily a change to the end user experience, and certainly not a positive change to the end user experience in some ways, because the book lover at the time scorned the idea of buying books online versus going to your local bookstore to find them. But what this fundamentally changed was that distribution of books became a post-sale rather than a pre-sale activity. Right? What you previously needed to do was to distribute books to all of the bookstores in the world if you wanted to access all the people in the world. With the invention of Amazon, with the invention of the online bookstore, all of a sudden, you could decide to distribute a book to a physical location after someone in that physical location had bought the book, right? And that fundamental change was the beginning of the long tail economy and a radical change to the way demand works for mass produced goods, not only books. And that brings us to the last stage of this journey and where we are today with the shift to ebooks as the primary means by which fiction is distributed today. So we now have a book that's written in a digital format, that's edited and typeset in a digital format, that is sold in a digital store, that is read on a digital display, that is reviewed and discussed in digital forums, right? So we have what appears to be this entirely digital service economy around the book. But if we look at the sharp edge, the tip of the spear of this huge, complex, intangible service ecosystem, what do we see? We see a physical device, this Kindle in the reader's hand, which has the job of enabling this entire activity system, but also giving meaning to it, representing it, being the piece of it that exists in the real world. So it becomes both the tool and the object. And it's so easy to explain to someone how this works by just saying, yeah, you have this reader and you can buy any book you want on it and read it there. You don't need to explain the whole complexity of the ecosystem that's behind it. And that's one of the wonderful things about physical objects, is that they can become this kind of immediately understandable representation, manifestation of very complex systems that sit behind them. And I think that's, in some ways, the new challenge and the new space that, that industrial designers sit in this world is, to some degree, those physical objects, those physical touch points remain for us physical beings, right? The place where the rubber hits the road for this digital service economy. So what are some of the characteristics of things today that we need to be very fluent with as industrial designers working today? First of all, this idea of connectedness, right? So it's the norm. It's almost the expectation, right, that things are connected to the internet or to the cloud, right? And what does that connectedness need? What are the expectations that come with it, connectedness, that any piece of information can be connected to any other piece of information, right? So that there are no silos between different information domains, and that physical devices act as a bridge or a portal in some way between this physical world that I'm in and the information world. So this example is a device that we designed called the Plume, which is a pollution sensor, a portable pollution sensor. And some of the things that that can do, because it's connected, because multiple people have them, and the data from all of the sensors is gathered in the cloud and intersected with geolocation data, with traffic data, with weather data, we can start to do things like recommending a route to get from A to B in the city, avoiding the worst pollution areas, recommending a time of day in which to perform a given activity in order to minimize your exposure to urban pollution. So if you were designing a pollution sensor 20 years ago, you would probably design a device with a display that gives you a value of the current levels of pollution, and that's it. Today, if you're designing a pollution sensor, you have to go beyond that, understand what are the journeys, what are the activities that that information is going to be used for, and try to build on top of the data in a way that makes it relevant and useful to everyday life journeys. So connectedness is not just devices connecting to the internet. It's how do I connect different information domains together? How do I connect that to the life journey of my user in a way that is meaningful and relevant? Second really important characteristic we need to be thinking more and more about is autonomy, right? We come from, you know, 200 years since the start of the Industrial Revolution of machines that are more and more powerful in terms of their ability to go faster perform their tasks more accurately with greater precision, whatever the parameter is, but essentially need to be told what to do. Need to be guided, need to be driven, need to be instructed by a human operator. And now we're coming into an age where instead more and more objects will autonomously pursue higher order goals. The example here is a delivery robot that we worked on with an Italian startup called Yape. So this is a robot that will go around on the footpaths in a city delivering packages to users without any human supervision. And this creates a completely new dynamic in the relationship between humans and machines, we used to have essentially two domains, either machines that are instructed by humans and do exactly what we tell them to do, or machines that go about their business like a manufacturing machine, repeating exactly the same task again and again and again with no human intervention. Now we have this new domain of machines that are autonomous and decide what to do next, and that are present in our everyday lives. And this is going to completely change how we interact with objects, and is a domain that the designers of the next 20 years are going to need to be more and more comfortable with. And then third and last is this idea of service touch points, of objects as primarily as service touch points. What you see here, the watches that these two people are wearing, is a watch that we worked on called the Tick Watch for an artificial intelligence company in China, not a watch company. And it's a watch that you can talk to in Chinese with advanced natural language processing capabilities, and becomes a touch point to an artificial intelligence assistant in your everyday life. And so more and more physical devices, as we talked about with the Kindle, are a way of placing in the context of my everyday life, on my body, in my home, in my workplace, in my car, on the street, placing service touch points that give me access to, you know, a whole universe of information-based services that are available to me now as part of my everyday life journey. And so I think these are three themes. There are more, of course, but three themes that I think an industrial designer today needs to tackle, needs to grapple with, needs to become fluent in, these ideas of connectedness, of autonomy, and of the object as a service touch point. And now I would like to open it up for questions.
Yeah, guys, I think it was very nice presentation, especially the example of cricket. I think it's very relevant, and, you know, I learned quite a few things like activity systems, you know, with a very nice example. Yeah, I'm sure that they have a lot of questions they'll ask one by one, perhaps. Because we all are anxious. Yeah, Saran, please go ahead.
Hi, Saran, can you hear me?
Yes. Yes. Saran, it would be nice if you can turn on your video, if that's possible.
So my question is sort of related to why my video won't turn on. I've got a masking tape over my webcam. So you talk about connectivity, and you also mentioned about, you know, you raised the topic of the Tick Watch. Which, I mean, I'm a brief introduction about myself. I'm the editor at Yanko Design. We're a blog that covers design news from across the world. So I've featured the Tick Watch also before, and I did a little bit of digging up as well. My question is basically, where can a designer's conscience help them design products that don't end up damaging users in the long run when it comes to privacy, when it comes to, you know, the breach of privacy, and just, you know, infringing on a lot of behaviors and predicting a lot of behaviors that probably users won't want to. You're also talking about, you know, these sort of artificially intelligent devices that also, you know, affect the behavior of children and capture data on children when, you know, they really haven't signed up and they haven't agree to any terms and conditions. So do you think designers should, you know, have a very strong conscience when it comes to designing such products and probably, you know, inform their clients?
Yes. I mean, the short answer is yes. I think, you know, we need to focus as much on the consequences, if not more on the consequences of what we are designing than on the thing we are designing itself, right? Ultimately, you know, our client has certain desired consequences, right? What they call business outcomes, right? So that's what we're being paid to try to obtain. It's not the product itself, but the impact, business impact of that product. But there are also consequences, you know, for the users of the product and for the non-users of the product as well, right? And the more products are part of complex systems, the harder it can be to figure out what those intended or unintended consequences might be. So yes, I think we do have a responsibility over that. It requires, you know, a systemic approach. One needs to start to think about products as part of a system, and I've kind of shared one lens on that of today in terms of activity systems. But it is, I believe it is a fundamental responsibility of designers, together with the other professionals who work in developing new products and services, to think about both the intended and the unintended consequences of what we design, and to try to, you know, shift the needle of those towards the positive.
Yeah, thank you so much. Yeah, I think, Hari, we can move on to the other questions.
So I see another hand up.
Hello, sir. So I'm Rishabh, so I'm a final year product design student. So what I was recently thinking about is quite mentioned in the last question from Sarang. So he mentioned about the fact that products do have a mental impact on the users most of the times. So we are responsible for that. You already said discussed about it. But what about products like social media websites like Instagram? They have good users as well as bad users. So it depends upon the user's mentality. Like how will it be? Like suppose if someone is trying to compare themselves to other things, like I've been watching you going through a few documentaries. So how should we deal with such scenarios where a product could be useful and harmful depending on the user's mentality? So how should we deal with such situations?
And here we come to, you know, the classical abdication of responsibility, right? Where the most extreme example is the classic guns don't kill people, people kill people response, right? I think we cannot abdicate responsibility, right? So social media as an example, there are mechanisms designed into social media platforms that explicitly drive certain forms of behavior over others, right? And unfortunately, you know, in the pursuit of the business models of some social media platforms, they have decided that they're not going to try to reduce some of those negative forms of behavior, because in reducing those forms of negative behavior, they also reduce their own income, right? Yeah. So there was a great recent study that the Facebook internal research team in Facebook did around developing an algorithm that would actually reduce exposure to messages and posts that other users had signaled as being fake news, right? And they tested this algorithm, and it worked. It actually stopped those items from circulating, but there was a corresponding effect of reducing people's time spent on the platform.
Yes, sir.
And so they shut it down, right? And so it's this demonstrates two things, right? One is gotta be careful with your business model, because that's going to drive your behavior. Ultimately, it's a corporation, and that in many cases may be outside the scope of our role as a designer. But the other thing that it illustrates is that there are mechanisms that can be designed in to products and platforms that shift the needle slightly away from the harmful uses and towards the positive uses, and very slight shifts in a complex system
can have huge
ramifications, right?
Yes, sir.
That's what we need to look for, is what are those nudges that we can design in that can shift things slightly to the positive and slightly away from the negative, that at scale can have a big impact.
Yes, sir. So it's quite it's a thing that was bothering me, like, how should we design products which doesn't have a negative impact? So that was something that was quite I was thinking about. So nice to have a discussion with you, sir.
Will we take one more question?
Yeah. So you are mute. So you're mute. Yeah.
Oh yes, Ayush.
Okay, somebody else is asking a question, so should I go?
Yes, please, Ayush. Please ask your question. Yes.
Sir, I had a question about automation. So how we are moving towards automation in today's time. So if things that are as almost abstract as social media can have such major impacts on the people, on the user's mentality and how it affects them. So how do we ensure that now the automated things that are making decisions for themselves are not sooner or later going to start working against humanity? It's sort of far-fetched, but it's also very realistic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a great point. I think one thing that can be helpful there is to apply in our thinking about an autonomous object that same hierarchy of operations, actions, and activities that I described to you in terms of human activities, right? Let's take a car as an example, right? A car with a built-in protection mechanism that will automatically start braking if you come too close to the car in front of you, or automatically swerve you back into the lane if you start drifting out of your lane. That is applying automation at the operational level, right? The actions that you should be doing as a driver without even thinking about it, and for whatever reason you have not, right? And the machine is kicking in to support you there. A car that, if you tell it, take me to the university, will take you to the university. That's acting at the actions level, right? That's making the decision to decide, when to change lanes, when to turn the indicator on, when to accelerate, when to slow down, in order to get you to the goal that you have defined, right? So you are still in charge of the activity. You have still decided today I'm going to go to university and take my class. I'm going to take the car. Then the highest level of automation would be a car that travels around the city looking for people who need a ride and taking them where they want to go. Now, that is now the activity level. It has now substituted the activity of a taxi driver in its entirety, not just at the level of a single ride. And I think the ethical and societal consequences get more and more complex the higher you get up that chain. I don't have any answers for you around how we avoid negative consequences from that beyond saying, you know, we've got to think them through on the individual cases. I would say that the experience, if you look at the experience of the journey I talked to you through around the written word, what we learn from that is the waves of disruption driven by technological capability cannot be stopped. They cannot. They will happen. And our role as designers is, can we make them happen in a way that is more human, more humanistic? So, I deeply believe designers do not drive disruption, do not drive the innovations and the macro changes in our society. But our role is, can we make those better for people, for individuals living in our society? Can that technology be more accessible to them? Can its benefits be more equitably distributed? Can it be more pleasant? Can it be more integrated into their everyday lives? These are the challenges that, if we choose the path of being designers, we choose to work on.
Right, but wherever there's decision making involved, there will be certain positive impacts and certain negative impacts of each decision. Mm-hmm. And as humans, we have a certain ethical and emotional side, which AI does not. So certain decisions that it makes, as in when it gets more and more automated and higher decision making levels. So the risks and the benefits will also be greater. So, like you're saying, there is no way that we can stop that, like as designers.
There's no way we can stop the change happening. There are many ways that we can try to make that change more human. Specifically on this topic, I would recommend to look for the work of Timnit Gebru. She's just been fired from Google. She's one of the greatest ethics of AI researchers in the US. That's a great starting point. And if you start with her, you will find a ton of resources and thoughts thinking on the ethics of AI specifically, which is a huge and fascinating topic.
Right. Thank you so much.
All right. I would love to stay and take more questions, but I have a quarter of an hour to squeeze in some lunch before my next call. So I'm going to have to call it quits here.
Okay. All right. One final thank you to you, Thomas. Thanks a lot. It was a pleasure listening to you and a lot of wisdom over the years. We are indeed very grateful and thankful.
All right.
Yes.
Thank you, guys. It was lovely to meet you all. Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye. I thank all our viewers too for being patient and most of them have been, you know, from all the sessions. So thanks a lot. And we end this series today. Thanks a lot, Shobik and Sagar and all the, students of PD for contributing in your own, in your different ways. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, Shobik, you have something to say or we close the session?
No, I just wanted to say thanks. It's been a great effort, a great initiative on your part that you kind of arranged this thing so that we could get some really eminent speakers through all our contacts combined, and we could get them to come here and share their thoughts with us, I'm sure the students have gained from it. I've gained from it. So I really hope that we make this an annual affair. So that's all I wanted to add.
Yes. Okay. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you.
Yeah, Rishabh.
Yes, sir. We'll be waiting for the part two for this session.
Yes. Okay. Sure. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.